Hello and welcome to Impact Africa, our online talk show where we get to have conversations with diverse people and organizations who are impacting lives and communities positively. This is your girl, Kemi Akiode Adebayo, aka Mama K. And into this program, I've got with me a gentle, diligent woman of faith, Ms Gooch, who is based in Cape Town, South Africa. And we're actually going to be talking about coping with grief today. So welcome to Impact Africa, Mama Kathy. Although I know you are Mama K as well. So this is you, Mama K.
Oh, bless you. Bless you, the other Mama K.
Right. So tell us, you know, who Mama K is. And, you know, your background, where you were born, whatever you want to share with us. And how did you get into, you know, being involved with supporting people with, you know, experiencing grief?
Yeah, okay. Well, you can tell by my accent that I'm not from here. My heart is here, but my accent is from Canada. So
whereabouts in Canada?
Just outside Toronto, Ontario.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was born and raised there and was raised there. And then when I was 17, God spoke to me very, very clearly that I would be a missionary. I went, I did my early child education university degree. And I thought, you know, I'm going to end up in South America working with underprivileged children. But he had other plans, and I ended up in the UK for nearly 7 years.
Okay.
And
what were you doing in the UK? Was it missionary work at that stage?
Well, it wasn't at that point. Well, it wasn't. I wasn't a full-time volunteer. I ended up working in an organization with underprivileged children as a nursery school teacher. And then I ended up with YWAM, Youth of the Mission. In 1992, and God did a lot of work in my heart, a lot of work. I was born again when I was 8, but
at 8, that's young. Wow.
8 years old, grew up in a Christian home, 8 years old. Okay. And then I had a lot of issues and stuff that God needed to work it with and
right.
For me. By the time I was finishing my time in the UK, he had really radically come to me in a very, very beautiful personal way. So, that's where I ended
and
up.
How did you find yourself in Cape Town? And how long have you been in Cape Town now?
I've actually been in Africa since 1999.
And
I was in Zimbabwe for 10 years. Oh. And then I came to Cape Town in 2009 and have been here since.
Right.
So I am now with YWAM, Youth of the Mission, full-time missionary.
Right.
I do serve Every Nation Baxter Church on the pastoral
team. Yeah. Wow, that's interesting. So that's an interesting journey from Canada, Toronto to UK and then Zimbabwe and then, you know, now in Cape Town on missionary work. And, you know, obviously you said God spoke to you at a very young age, at the age of 17, to do missionary work. And that was clear, you know, like you said, and God was walking, you know, through you as well in a radical way. I like that term, you know, because sometimes when we, you know, for me anyway, and what I've heard is, when we hear God speak, sometimes, you know, for those who are believers, sometimes we're not obedient or we just feel, you know, is it me hearing it or is it something else? And we kind of do our own thing. So it's interesting from a very young age, you know, born again at the age of 8 and ending up, you know, here. So how did you get into the work or why? Because that's the area I know, and I'm sure there are other areas, you know, for you. How did you get into counseling or working with people with grief?
Well, that's, again, an interesting journey. And what happened was I was overseeing pastorally the University of Cape Town students because they were a lot were coming to our church. And it was 2016 that the protests started on the campus, very, very intense. And that's when God was speaking to me about attending to pain, the area. And you could see that on the campus with students. They were going through a lot of past and present pain. And yeah, he spoke to me about being a wounded healer. And it was basically the end of 2016, beginning of 2017, that I felt that he was saying to create a play to do with pain.
Okay.
And I think often the church doesn't address pain or help people process pain, although pain is a big part of our lives here on earth, isn't it? So,
oh, it is.
Yeah.
So that is an interesting one. And now we'll go on to the topic itself, which is about coping with grief, which, you know, I believe everybody, grief is a universal thing and, you know, associated with pain. And yes. I believe, you know, with everybody in one's life, you do have an experience that changes or alters your life.
Yeah.
And grief could be in the form of the death of a loved one or even your pet. Because sometimes, you know, some of us have pets, you know, who have become family. Right. So could be experienced, you know, in terms of divorce or changes in your relationship, including friendship as well, and changes in your health, losing a job, changes in your finances, changes in your way of life, especially even this time of COVID now. And I know over the last 2 years, going to 2 years now, that we've all had to accept this new norm of living this COVID period, a lot of people are experiencing grief. So, Mama K, in your words, what is grief? What does grief mean to you? And what are the stages, you know, that people go through when they're grieving? And you could pick any, whether it's loved ones, whatever you want to focus on.
Sure. Basically, you can't grieve unless you've loved. It's the price you pay for loving someone. So my dad passed away the end of 2017. I got the news Christmas Day. I was traveling with my friend on a road trip. I was near Durban, and I got an email from my oldest brother in Canada that my dad had suddenly passed away. And it was very difficult for me to navigate. He was the first person close to me that I had lost. And even though I was old, I was well in my 50s by then, I still was going through this extreme sadness, overwhelmed by sadness. I could describe it like a cloud was just following me all the time, and I couldn't shake it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of the person who likes to understand what I'm going through. I'll search, find out, okay, what am I going through? What can we do? Because I notice what a lot of people don't do well, especially in the body of Christ, is help grieving people. And so I basically became a guinea pig or a bit of a pilot project to go through this, to help others know what to do with the likes of me or anyone like me. So I was very open and honest on my journey. And as I discovered things about grief, and learning about grief, I would share it with others. I would be very, and because I thought we can't afford to miss what's happening. We can't afford to leave people alone. And I was very much alone in my own grief. And yeah, people didn't know what to do with me, probably because I was a leader and I was in a pastoral position. Is like, okay, what do you do with someone in that position? Do you leave them alone? Do you help them? And I'm going, but I'm human. You know, we're all human, and we all need human touch, don't we? We all need human practicality, meals being made or something like that. So, I mean, I don't know if you're going to show the grief chart, but.
Yeah, we will. Okay, we'll get our technical to show the grief chart. That will just come up, and it's just interesting, you know, what you've said, your personal journey being the guinea pig, you know, like you said, kind of, but people not knowing, you know, how to handle you. So yeah, technical, we need the grief chat up. Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, there we go. So just let you talk through it for us.
So I mean, it's again a beautiful way to help people know what they're going through, because many people especially haven't gone through grief before. They don't know what they're going through. Mm-hmm. So this helped me to put handles on it or words to what I was experiencing. So the first level, shock, numbness, denial, emotional outbursts, those are very typical of someone who's just heard they've lost a loved one. And then essentially you kind of mix and mingle that with anger, fear, searchings, disorganization, panic. And I found myself quite angry, and I will be honest, angry with God, because I had served him. I had served other people in their own grief. And then I'm finding on the backside that people don't know how to serve me or help me. And, you know, you're kind of left to your own devices, which you're not strong. You're weak. And I didn't mind admitting I was weak. And so what do I do with that? And then moving to...
if you scroll down, I think there's the one at the bottom, technical. There we go. So that was stage one and two you were talking about, kind of.
Yes.
So,
then going into three, you're going to deal with loneliness, guilt, isolation, depression, shame, reentry troubles. These are all possibilities, Mama Kay, but it isn't necessarily what everyone goes through, because we all have our own journey to go through. And then as we come through the healing and
can you scroll up, technical? Thank you.
Find the new norm, because
leave it there now. Thank you.
It's not, and then going into new relationship, new strengths, new patterns, hope, affirmation, helping others. And as you can see, we go, it's the valley of the shadow of death from Psalm 23. It's so appropriate. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. So we need to go through it. And I needed to go through it. It was also a cathartic journey for me. Because again, I did the play. We actually did do that play in August 2018 called The Three Cries, to do with pain and to do with, okay, how does Jesus see our pain? What about Jesus's pain? What about his hope? What about what we need to look to help us through these times? Who do we need to look through these times? And as I myself was doing that, then I was able to help others to find their way through the valley of the shadow of death.
So within all the different five stages, because I know in some cases it could even be seven or eight, you know, depending on where. So like you said, everybody's journey is different. And some, it could be a case of where you could even start from the anger, which is showing in stage two, you know, rather than even being shocked. You could just be even angry. And then you could go on to being shocked. And then, you know, and then what happens, and I think that the bottom one, stage three, was the depression, isolation, loneliness, which I believe is actually the most dangerous one, where some people that I've worked with, either family or friends, are either stuck in that stage, you know, where they've been through anger, they've been through the shock, they've been through all that, and they're kind of, they're not going into that four, which is talking about, you know, even having hope. They feel there's no hope, you know, for the future. So how can we help, you know, through what you're doing, you know, for people to move, you know, from the stage of wherever they are, you know, to a stage that is healthy? Because grief is part of life. It is part of life. And, you know, like you're saying, you know, if we need to go through the various forms, you know, as well, you know, to get through there. But what I'll do before you, maybe I'll let you answer, and then I'll go on to the next, then we'll have a break. But I'll let you reply. Thank you, Mama Kathy.
Yeah, thank you so much. So basically, I think one of the best things you can do for someone is to listen to them and allow them to be wherever they are in their emotions. If they're angry with God or people or the situation, let them be angry. Don't try and say, no, we're not supposed to be all that stuff. Let them be that, because what I learned is that just because they're there then doesn't mean they'll stay there or remain there. I did not remain there. It was just a little piece of my journey that I needed to walk through and sort out with God and with others too. So it's best to allow people to be wherever they are on their journey and to listen. I mean, a big part is just let them talk. Or if they don't want to talk, let them be silent. Don't feel you have to fill everything in with your words or cliches or even Bible verses. It's just something, it's being super sensitive to where they are at in their humanity. And to let them be real, let them be raw. I think that helped me is and I had to allow myself to be that too.
Because right.
I'm in a pastoral position, it's like, oh, am I almost allowed to? But I said, wait a minute.
Exactly.
I'm human. And you know what? I could do the body a big favor by being honest where I'm at, because they're going to go through this themselves. You know, and this is pre-COVID. This is pre-losing so many people as we have in the last little bit. And I'm going, if I can help someone now, it'll help them in the long run, having no idea we were going to hit, you know, this massive pandemic.
Right. So
that's really a few things that I would say to help others is really to allow them to be whoever they are at that moment in time, not to be afraid of where they are at that moment in time. And allow them to be there. And then, you know, walk them, when they're ready, then walk them through, you know, are you ready to forgive? Are you ready to let go? Are you ready to surrender to God and what you don't know, you don't understand? And being very compassionate is a huge thing with those who are grieving. I mean, if anybody showed me compassion, you know, just by, again, hardly anybody brought me a meal, but once I told them that I wasn't doing well and you guys need to step up here, wow, I had all these visitors and everything. And I tell you, I would start crying at just one little touch of compassion. Because I wasn't used to receiving compassion. I was used to giving it.
Perfect.
Yes. And so compassion goes so, so far with people that they know, you know what, this person actually cares about me and is willing to sit here with me in my dust and my ashes. Yes. And not quickly push them on to the next thing. You know, we have to be extremely patient with people during their time of grief.
Wow. Okay. We'll be right back. That's a lot in there. We'll be right back. Okay. Before we ended that first segment, you know, there. One of the things as well is where, you know, people feel, get out of, you know, by now you should have finished grieving, you know, and things like that. Is there a time, is there a length for how long people can grieve? And, you know, when or how does, you know, when do people start recovering from grief, or is it a life thing?
Yeah, no, it's a good question, Mama Kay. Very good question, and we're still learning this, aren't we? But because it's such a personal journey, you know, there is no mandated way of doing your journey. It's as individual as a fingerprint. But what is important is you go through the valley of the shadow of death, not around it, over it, under it, not avoiding it, but going through it. And as you go through it, you find healing. Again, it's painful. It's painful going through it. But only as you go through it will you find that healing. And yeah, some of the things that I've learned along the journey is that healing comes in time, not with time.
Okay.
In time, but not with time.
Healing comes, sorry, in, say that again.
Healing comes mm-hmm. in time, not with time.
Okay.
So it comes in time, but it doesn't have a specific time because everybody's journey is different.
Different.
And that we can't rush it. We're not to rush it. We're to go through it. I went through mine very methodically, very thoroughly. I did everything I could to help myself understand what I was going through. So on the other side, I now can be that wounded healer that helps other people.
Other people.
Yeah, if I because did.
Because if you were still struggling and not there yet on that other side, then you will not be of use to anyone, at the end of the day.
Exactly. And you can't give what you haven't received or accepted or acknowledged for yourself. So I definitely see, in time, we absorb grief and it becomes part of who we are. We don't get rid of it. We absorb it into our lives. It becomes part of us. And what I have found, it has the potential to enlarge our hearts.
Right.
So that you can now include others with you in that journey and help others in that journey. And, I'm even finding there's some kids that I've been helping through grief and they make comments, someone else is having grief because there's just so many people losing people right now. It's overwhelming. And they're saying, as I help someone, I know I'm still going through it, but as I just say one little thing that's helped me, it ends up helping someone else. It's like, that little fire candle that you end up lighting another candle.
Yeah, lighting.
That kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that's basically what I have found along the way is, there isn't necessarily a time frame.
But so there's no start and there's no end, really. But it's just making sure, along the journey, you have people around you as well.
Yes. Exactly. I'm now coming into in December it'll be 4 years since my dad passed. No, I'm not still grieving. I'm not. Probably maybe after the second year, I was getting healed and confident and reassured. But it just depends. It depends on people and where they're at.
Where you're at. Yeah. So I know you shared earlier, before we had the break, where you actually gave some tips on, what to do, and how to help people grieving, which were things like to listen, to be compassionate and, to be sensitive, to be real with them. Yeah. Is there any other, kind of tips as well that you want to add, to that? Or because I'm sure there's a lot, in there. And I believe the biggest one is listening. Because sometimes, listening to that person, where we are, snap out of it. Oh, why are you still mourning? Oh, it's only this and only that. Are we listening to that person? Are we being compassionate with that person? So is there any other tips that you feel, even the individual themselves to help themselves, that they could, do? Or if I want to help somebody, how can I help? What can I do? Like you said, sometimes when you need to allow them to be silent, not just, just be talking. Somebody like me, I've learned how to do that because you just feel you want to, it's awkward, when somebody has lost someone and you really don't know, how to process it, especially a big loss. Every loss is big.
Sure.
But I've had someone who, lost 3 members of the family over 6 months and I'm like, I don't know what to say to this person. Yeah. How? What? What tips can what other things can one do?
Sure. A very good question. And a lot of us need to know this. For those who are grieving, again, what I've learned along the way is that it's okay not to be okay.
Right. That's a good one that you haven't been saying and it needs to be said more.
Yeah. It's okay not to be okay. And it's okay to be weak. And this is your time to be weak It's not your time to be strong. It's not your time. You know, I have people telling
because
me, well,
because people say be strong, you
there
know?
There you go, exactly.
I'm caught up in that, and I'm exactly. like, strong, yeah. really? Yeah.
No. You've just had something pulled, someone pulled
yeah,
from you.
From you.
Yeah, so it's like a stool. You know, you've got a three-legged stool, and there's a pole who's been ripped out. Now you're imbalanced. You've fallen over. You're weak. For people, it's not helpful for them to say to a bereaved person, be strong.
Right.
Don't cry. Oh, those are the almost the worst things.
Well, there's even the term, even in the Christian faith, I don't know, I'll share this, but I struggle with it. I'm just being honest with you. It is said, like, the person is in a better place. When we die, we all, you know, those who are Christians, you know, we die and we want to go and meet Jesus. And, you know, it's about, yes, we all want to go to heaven, but yes, you don't want to go now. You want to fulfill, you know, have children, grandchildren, or whatever your calling is, you know, save the world, whatever it is. So when people, for me, I don't know, I'm being honest with you,
yeah.
I struggle. I don't feel comfortable using that term.
Yeah.
That, oh, the person is in a better place. You know, I know, yes, you know, they're there with Jesus, and if they're Christian, and they were born again, and blah, blah, blah. But I just look, if I was the one grieving, I don't think I want to hear that. Don't know why.
I definitely agree. Again, we're trying to use what we think is helpful for a person. Mm. And the be strong, the don't cry, they're in a better place, you know, if they're born again, lovers of Jesus. Yes, that's true. That's good news, but it's not.
It's not what the person wants to hear.
It's not what they need to hear at that time.
Yeah.
It's compassion. It's coming alongside. It's listening or be silent. Be practical. It's all those kinds of things. So I do agree with what you're saying. We have to be careful not to use all these Christian cliches because we think, you know, we're just trying to make things better. Well, we can't. You can't make something better. It's something they're going to have to go through. They need to know they're not alone in that process, that there is a shoulder to cry on. Or there is someone to, you know, all I want to do is talk. I am not a talker by nature. All I did was talk. And that's what came out of me. Whereas other people may shift to being quiet. Well, someone willing just to sit and be quiet.
Like for you, was it about talking about the memories you had with your dad, or was it just talking about how you felt?
Both. It was definitely both. It was definitely things that were grievances, were bothering me about what I would see in the body of Christ not kind of rising up and what you're called to do, to weep with those who weep. We're very good rejoicing with those who weep. Terrible weeping with those who weep.
Yeah.
So I'd be very verbal about those things and really call people to. I love them enough to call them to account, including myself in that. And just say, okay, you know, I think we can do things differently. Let's learn from this. And then for people who are going through grief, to be selfish. I'm going to say the only time I tell someone be selfish is when they're grieving.
Right.
Be selfish with, if you're not doing well, tell someone I'm not up to meeting you today. That's, I'm going to be selfish. Be gracious, be kind with yourself. If you can't do something, tell someone, I can't do it. You know, students, again, have lost parents. And I say, tell your lecturer, tell them, you've just lost a mom or a dad. You may not make that submission. And says, oh, can I really do that? Yes, do it. And hopefully they'll have compassion. And most people have compassion. They do say, you know what? It's okay. Your submission could be 2 weeks from now, whatever month.
Right.
But if you don't tell people, they won't
they
know.
Won't know. They won't know. They won't
know. So be kind and gracious with yourself. Be selfish, but also be verbal where you're at. I'm not doing well. Other people have to manage that. If I'm not doing well when I'm grieving, other people have to get over that. I'm trying to make it okay for them.
Yeah, wow. That was big time, wow. I've been enlightened, you know, here, and I believe, you know, our viewers as well would have been enlightened. And this is something I know we're condensing to, you know, the short time, you know, that we have. And there's a lot, you know, you've unpacked, you know, for all this. So thank you, you know, so much, you know, for that. And there's more, you know, that needs to do. And I know you've ran various workshops, you know, before, so I don't know whether there's any coming up through the Every Nation or other people, you know.
Yes.
We will share that, you know, at the end, if there's any coming up, and if you want us as well to share your contact for anyone to reach out to you for help or support or for direction, because that's another thing where people feel, you know, they don't want to, because especially those who are stuck in that depression kind of state, you know, helplessness and loneliness, and, you know, they need to get professional help, you know, counselors and therapists and so on. So, yeah, there's a lot there that you've unpacked. What I want to now ask kind of in my final kind of way now is, this is now back to you now. In 1996, this was something I didn't know about you, and I just kind of discovered now. You wrote a song called Shadows, You Felt My Pain, and you recorded it in 2019.
Yes.
So can you share with us the motivation for writing and singing that? And we're really going to play that song as well shortly, but can you share first with us, you know, the motivation behind that song?
Sure. Again, this wounded healer theme that started in, again, the end of 2016, beginning of 2017, I really believe that God was really highlighting what it was to be a wounded healer. And then, of course, me going through my own cathartic journey. He reminded me that I had written a song in 1996. He was ministering to me about something that I was going through when I was 17 years old. In fact, it was just before God spoke to me about becoming a missionary. And I was going through this situation, and God in 96, I think I'm about, well, I was born 1963, so I must have been around, what, 33 at the time? He's speaking to me about that time and that incident. And so he gives me words. I am a writer, so I write.
Okay.
And I was playing the guitar at the time, so I put some chords to it. It really was just for me. It really was me, God's ministering to me, reminding me that I wasn't alone when I thought I was at that time. And so I left it. I left it in the archives. I didn't remember it again. And then in 2019, he reminds me, he says, pull out that song from the archives, revise it. I got a guy, Kumbee, from the church to help me revise it, tweak it a little bit, and then sing with me. I'm not the strongest singer. I'm okay. But as long as the anointing is there, that, you know, and speaking or anything, I should be okay. But he helped me. And then, yeah, I got another guy at the church, Serge, to do the guitar, whatever they're called, playing the guitar. And then Becky helped me with the keyboard, playing keyboard, and he mixed it. So the end of 2019, we recorded it. Becky worked on the instrumentals. And then by 2020, he was working on that. By 2021, I thought, okay, let me put it on SoundCloud and see if it can help some people and minister to them as God had ministered to me through that song. So that's why I felt that's what he was saying to do.
Wow, so you're a woman of so many talents. You play the guitar, you write, you sing in your own way, like you said. So the track is available on Soundtrack, you said, for anyone.
SoundCloud.
So we will play now just some part of it, and people can listen to the full thing, you know, on SoundCloud, and we will share that detail. So technical, if you can just play the music for us, thank you. Thank you.
living at all. Where was my father when I needed him so much? To bear the burden I could no longer bear. But now as I look back in time, I realize he was there.
Okay, wow. Well, guys, if you want to listen to the full version, we will share the link at the end. And yeah, it's on SoundCloud. And that was a beautiful one. I loved it. That was a beautiful one. I just love that voice, and I could hear the sincerity in the fact that, yeah, you know, just listening to it could give you that calmness, you know, that yeah, God has, you know, felt your pain, and he's called our names. He knows our name, yeah. You know, all of us. So I don't know if there's anything else you want to add, and then I'll go in closing. If there's anything, you know, you want to say to our viewers out there, especially those struggling with grief or the loss of a loved one at this time, or loss of loved ones,
yeah.
Family, colleagues, and so on. Yeah.
Yeah, I think Mama K, basically to allow yourselves to be wherever you are at the time. And of course, people are meant to come alongside. We are meant to practice Ubuntu, community. That's the way God created us. We're still learning that, I think.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll get better at that. But most of all, that God is there with you. And, you know, Jesus walked this earth feeling what we feel, the pain, the grief. He lost Lazarus, even though he knew he was going to raise him from the dead. He still wept. He still wept because it was a very good friend of his. And he allowed himself to be there to show us that we can look to him to be there for us and with us. I think the big thing is the withness of God. And that we aren't a shadow. We're not someone that isn't seen for what we're going through. We are seen. We're not a shadow anymore. And he is there with us, no matter what. Emmanuel, God with us. And I think that's something that unbelievers won't have. They won't have that witness of God. And when you have Jesus in your lives, you can trust him to be with you no matter what. I walk through the valley of shadow death, you will be with me. Your rod and your staff will comfort me. I don't need to fear evil. You're with me. And to constantly remember the good shepherd is with you no matter what you're going through, and to cry out to him and to look to him. And that's just something that I've been learning, and I've hopefully am helping others to look to Jesus, the author and perfecter of their faith, to look to him, to turn their eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace, and to allow him to be that to them. And also, Mama Kay, I do want to say this, that God doesn't get put off by our emotions.
Right.
We are made to be emotional, and he is emotional. Well, how could we be emotional, made in his image, if he wasn't? So he doesn't get put off. Wherever we are at, he's still on the throne. He isn't insecure. And, and he loves us no matter wherever we are at, and he's there with us no matter where we are at. And I think that's what I have found so beautiful, so beautiful about his nature and his character, is that he's living with us. Yeah. So shall I pray now or wait till you're finished?
Yes. No. You can.
Oh, super. Yeah, Daddy God, we come before you because we can, because you invite us to come. And we take you up on your invitation to come as we are, no matter where we are in our grief, in our loss, in our confusion, in our numbness, in our anger, in our denial, in any state that we are in. We come to you because you say come, and because you invite us to come. And so I do pray for anyone listening here who needs to know, yes, they are not a shadow anymore, that you, in the eyes of the Father, they're not a shadow. You see them, you know them by name, you love them, you have called them, and that you know that our frames are but dust, and you know that we go through so much here on this earth, and you have positioned yourself to be with us no matter what we go through. And that's what we call upon, is the withness of God for these dear, dear, precious people who are going through loss right now, the withness of God. And we ask this in your name, Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
Amen. Wow, what a very powerful session for us. Thank you so much, Mama Kathy Gooch. And there's a lot, you know, like I said, that you've unpacked there. And there's a lot of help out there as well, you know, in terms of professional help, in terms of support group. And I like, you know, some of your comments, you know, about being compassionate, to listen. It's okay not to be okay. The bit about healing comes in time, not with time.
Yes.
That is so powerful, you know, so for people to remember. And be it whether loss of a loved one, loss of a job, loss of a relationship, the same thing applies. You will go through the different stages, you know, from the anger, the loss, and the hurt, the pain, the searching, the fear, you know, and the shame, depression, and so on. You might not necessarily go through all that as well, because we all handle things, you know, differently. And we learned there as well that it's not about how long, you know, it is. So we need to just respect and give people space. If we need to be silent, to be silent. We then need to, for that person as well, to be able to express their own feelings, you know, as well, because if you don't say, people will not know. So feel free to express your feeling, especially the strong ones amongst us, or those in leadership, be it in church, mosque, school, business. We don't have to be too strong. We can cry. Like you said there, Jesus wept. Yes. Jesus wept. You know, he expressed his own grief as well, you know, through that. So we need to ask for help, you know, when we need it. Yeah. And it's okay. It is okay. Yeah. So thank you so much, you know, for your time. And I believe your prayers as well will go and, you know, down to those, you know, who will hear it and will make a difference, you know, for them. And I wish you all the best, you know, with all that you're doing and all that you continue to do. And I pray that God will continue to use you to impact lives, be it the students on campus, be the community in the church, friends, and so on, you know, other people that you help, you know, through what you're doing, through your music, through your counseling, through your I'm looking forward to maybe you playing the guitar or something next time.
I haven't picked it up for a while.
Well, I'm challenging you now for you to pick it up and for us to hear you play it. Like, thank you. So that's where we'll stop, and we will share details at the end for people to get help, you know, wherever, you know, they want to. So thank you all for watching. And this is Mama K. Till next time, remember, stay safe, stay blessed. God is love, and love you all. And please you know, reach out to others, you know, that are struggling, especially at this time. And if you feel you're struggling yourself, reach out. Let people know. It's okay. Let them know. The worst they can tell you is they can't help you, and go to the next person who might be able to help you. So thank you all for watching, and till next time on Impact Africa. God bless.